I call this talk Doing Egalitarianism. So government in India is, as all of us are aware, is doing this affirmative action to end caste differences, to end differences of class, especially caste, because caste is seen as something which is a blot on Indian society. And from the point of view of anthropology, if you look at studies of societies, when anthropologists go to these areas, they have a very top-down approach. They look at themselves as rationalists, as we were just discussing over lunch, that we look at ourselves as rationalists and scientists, and we are doing science, whereas the natives are doing their own practices, which need to be documented and need to be observed. But once you look at them, you cannot help but get affected by what's happening. And this is what a lot of anthropologists are doing today, that they have discovered a new field which is called STS, or Science and Technology Studies. And so the way we have been looking at native societies, the way we've been looking at tribes in the past, most anthropologists do that. They look at tribes, they go and live with communities, they do their field work, they bring back the data, they put it down in nice books, and they are sold as ethnographies, they are sold as scientific studies of societies. What anthropologists have begun to do now is they have started looking at science in much the same way. So they are looking at laboratories, they are looking at hospitals, they are looking at institutions that we think of as scientific. And so one of the anthropologists and philosophers who has influenced me a lot is a lady called Anne Mary Mol. Her work is based in a hospital in Netherlands, and she has looked at one particular disease, one very obscure disease called atherosclerosis, which happens in aging Europeans. So it generally afflicts aging Europeans, it generally afflicts males. So, you know, it's a very, very specific disease and a very, very specific condition when your nerves, they become filled with calcium and you start feeling the pain. And so the expressions she uses for this particular disease is called doing disease. So when you actually look at people who are afflicted by this disease, in a very wide sense, what she does is she sits with doctors when they interview patients, when the patient first comes for a consultation. This is what all of us do when we fall sick or when we need treatment. We go to a doctor and we tell the doctor our stories, our narratives of the disease. So what she has realized that the narratives are all different. For a disease which is like bracketed as one condition in the medical terminology is experienced differently by every individual who is afflicted by it. Similarly, when surgeons look at the same disease, they look at it in a different way. When psychologists look at the same disease, they look at it in a different way. When the pathologist looks at the same disease, they are looking at it differently. So the person who experiences the disease is completely different, and the people who are trying to treat the disease, they are also looking at it in a different manner. And that, I think, is true for caste as well, because when we look at caste, we just look at it in a very wide sense of the term. But caste is experienced differently by different people all over India. It's not a uniform term, it's not an autonomous happening that, oh, these are the four varnas, these are the jatis, and so-and-so jati is exploiting so-and-so jati. It's a much more complicated turn of events, and that's what I want to talk to you about today, because Anne Mary Mol describes this particular disease as a multiple disease. She says it's not a uniform disease, it's not a one disease which can be treated in one particular way. So that's that to me is a nice way of looking at the caste problem as well, because people in different parts of the country experience caste in a different manner. Of course, some of the elements are similar. And then when you get back to anthropology, you realize that caste is was invented by the British. Indians did not know about the caste system. It was a creation of the British archive. It was the creation of the British gazetteers when the colonial officers started to think about caste. And the way we look at caste today is a very, very colonial way of looking at it. And that's what I want to talk about. So, Jaunsar is this, as Nikhil just mentioned, is this little area in little as I knew it when I first went to it, and turned out to be a very vast region. So, Jaunsar is, so when I went to Jaunsar, I began looking at the Devi Devta system. That is what I was supposed to do. That the Jaunsaris, they are mountain people. We think of them as remote tribals. They are a scheduled tribe recognized by the Constitution of India. So they were remote tribals to me as an outsider. And they followed this Devi Devta system, which I wanted to study and I wanted to learn more about. All I knew was that there is this temple in by the riverside, by the river called Hanol, by the river called Tons, which becomes Yamuna when it enters the plains. The site itself is called Hanol. And I thought I'll sit around the temple and look at what people do during the day and know what's happening in the society. Didn't turn out that way. So this is a picture of one of the devtas, who is the ruling deity of Jaunsar. But where is the devta? It's just four boys, four, five boys. The devta is inside the silver box that you see that they are carrying. So the devta is carried around in a palanquin. He's carried around in a box, which is carried by two people on the shoulders. I brought good weather from Jaunsar for you. So the palanquin has the tiger heads on the corners of the staff, and so it's not just a devta established inside a temple, but it's a devta who is carried around the entire space. So what really fascinated me at this moment was that most people referred to their devta as Devta Raja. So they added the term king to the when they addressed their devta. And generally, they talked of him in the first person as one would talk of a friend, that Mahasu, Mahasu, Mahasu. But Mahasu also became Devta Raja when I started delving a little deeper. And then I realized that I was looking at an area which was much more vast than I had expected. So it was not just Western Himalayas in Uttarakhand, but it extended all the way up to the river Satluj. So Mahasu Devta's influence extends all the way from Uttarakhand, from the Tons River. The Tons River, when it enters into Dehradun, into the Dun Valley, becomes Yamuna, and then it comes and joins the Ganga. So Mahasu Devta's influence extends all the way between Tons and the Satluj River. And before the British decided to make Simla their summer capital, the district of Simla was also referred to as District Mahasu. So this became quite complicated, because I suddenly realized that my field area has grown and I have two states to cover. So half of Himachal also got added to what I was doing. And so why I use this term kingdom when I talk about this whole area is because, as I mentioned, because of Devta Raja. So Generally what happens is that when we think of the Devi Devta system and we think of possession rituals, people get possessed by the Devta, we begin to rationalize, we begin to think in terms of superstition, we begin to think in terms of the natives doing something which is probably incorrect, unscientific and so on and so forth. But I realize that like Anne Mary Mole found the disease a multiple disease, I found the Devta also a multiple Devta, and the complexity just went on increasing, because this Devta was not just a deity, it was not just a god worshipped inside a temple, but it was also a very political god, and in fact he was the king. So this whole idea that I had of South Asian kingship just dissolved, because in anthropology there is a lot of literature, a lot of work has been done on South Asian kings, that who is a king, and the king's relationship to the Brahmin, and the king's relationship to the other warriors, and a lot of work has been done on this. But this particular region inverted the entire concept of a South Asian king, because normally what you have is you have a human king like the Rajas that we hear about in stories and history, and the king tries to derive a divine connection. The king says, I have the divine right to rule. But here this entire trope was completely inverted, because here was a Devta, here was a divinity, a god, who was saying that I am the king. So rather than a human king having a divine voice, here was a divine king, and then the divine king himself had a human voice. He had oracles. So he had people sitting in the temple all over the place, and people would come to these people, to these malis as they are called locally, they are oracles. So they claim that the king speaks to them, that the Devta Raja speaks through them. Ki they get possessed, unko Devta Raja aa jata hai, and then if there is a family dispute, you bring a family dispute to them. If there is a political dispute, you bring the political disputes to them. Even in this day and age, the oracles decide who will contest the MLA election, who will contest the MP election, and unless the Devta endorses a candidate's name, he cannot contest the election. So it's very much intertwined with the social system. And this is how the Devta travels. Whenever the Devta travels, whenever the Raja is traveling, he travels in state. So you have the regalia, you have the minister of the Devta, whom you can see holding the sword at this time. And so as Kautilya mentioned, you know, these seven preconditions for any kingdom in his Arthashastra, he talked about king, he talked about country, minister, army, fort, treasure, ally. And when I looked at Mahasu had all these attributes. He had lands registered in his name. So he had the territories, and he was himself the king. He has a minister to look after the state affairs. And the temples also, interestingly, they are referred to as courts. They are not referred to as mandir, but they are referred to as court, which in the local language roughly translates into fortress. And of course, he has a rich treasury. He had many allies with local human kings, because Mahasu's kingdom was surrounded all over by human kings, like the Raja of Tihri, like the Raja of Jubbal, and of course Veerbhadra Singh, who is currently the chief minister of Himachal Pradesh. His kingdom, Rampur Bashar. So he is the erstwhile Raja of Rampur Bashar, and they all had kind of alliances with Mahasu Devta, who ruled over this territory. So then when I started thinking that I knew a bit about Mahasu, Mahasu turned out to be four Mahasus. So the complexity grew even further. So if you look at this Google grab of the Taunce River. You can see the Taunce River flowing right through. And then I realized that there was one Devta in the center who is the Bodha Mahasu. So the temple is right here. If I can just get up. And so this is where the temple is. This is kind of an access to the kingdom. And this is Bodha Mahasu. He's the sitting Mahasu. This is the temple at Hanol that I visited first. But then I realized that there were four of them. And the river in itself is a kind of boundary that separates two kingdoms. So there's one Raja who sits here, which is the Pabasi Mahasu. And another one which is the Basik Mahasu. And then there is a fourth Raja who is the traveling king. So locals believe that Bodha Mahasu is disabled, he cannot walk. So even his idol has a defect. One of the legs is broken, so he's sitting there permanently and providing the access for the entire kingdom. And Chalda is the youngest and he is the fittest of all four. So Chalda is being carried throughout his kingdom. Of course, the locals believe that he's traveling, but because I come from science, so I have to say that he's being carried by his minister and his Rajput warriors. So we have to remember that there are four Mahasus actually and not just one Mahasu. So which brings us back to what is divine kingship. So here you see in the photograph, you can see Mahasu's oracle, who is throwing rice at Mahasu's devotees. In the background, you can see the white parasol of Mahasu, which is carried with him all the time. And then you see this little silver and gold box, not little, but quite a big one actually. Silver and gold box which holds the idol of Mahasu. And Mahasu is, by the way, he's carried throughout his kingdom. Chalda Mahasu spends 12 years on towards the Himachal side of the kingdom and 12 years in Jaunsar. So when the king is here in Jaunsar, people in Himachal keep waiting for him. They keep preparing for his arrival. And the arrival is quite spectacular. And as I mentioned earlier, Jaunsar as a case study inverts the entire idea of what we think of as a South Asian king. So you have this divinity who is claiming kingship rights rather than a king claiming divine rights. And the Raja is, Mahasu is a very big agentive force. So when we talk in terms of agency in anthropology, we, in very simple terms, we talk of forces that can change our lives, forces that can socially change what we are doing, the way we live. Those forces are called agents. And in this case, Mahasu turns out to be a very big agentive force. Because as many scientists have pointed out, that even though kingship has dissolved, even though the kings have gone, their privy purses have all gone, but kingship remains. Kingship stays with the people. Their loyalties, their primordial loyalties to dynasty don't fade away so easily. For instance, there's this picture of Veerbhadra Singh, who was the king of Rampur Bashar. So he has inherited the kingship from his forefathers, and people still think of him as one of the Rajas. And therefore, he doesn't need to canvass, he doesn't need to work that hard to get the votes. On the other hand, you have Tihri in Garhwal. So the Raja of Tihri is also a very interesting case, because the Raja of Tihri never got off his car. Wherever he went for canvassing, ever since Tihri merged with the Indian state, the Raja of Tihri contested elections as a member of parliament. He's always been a BJP nominee. He's always won, and he has never ever got off his car, because thinking that the masses would pollute his status as the Raja. So he would never get off the car. He would address audiences from the car. And when Atal Bihari Vajpayee became the Prime Minister of India, and Manojendra Singh won the election, the Raja of Tihri won the elections, he was invited to be a part of the Council of Ministers for Atalji's cabinet, and he was given the information and broadcasting portfolio, which he very famously declined, saying that I am a Raja. Main tumhara mantri kyun banunga, main to Raja hun, main Raja hi theek hun, aur mujhe nahi banna tumhara mantri. So he refused the cabinet minister rank, because he always thought of himself as the king. So kingship is still alive, even though the kings may have gone, the palaces may have gone. And once he died, his daughter-in-law is now the member of parliament from the Tihri constituency. By the way, she's a Nepalese lady. She's past class 11, barely. She can barely speak. But because she comes from the dynasty, there is no opposition, there is no contest against her. So at least in the mountains, I can't say of other places, but in the mountains, kingship is still alive and it's still kicking. And then we have the castes. So Jaunsaris, they are a Hindu caste society. And of course, you have Pujaris, who are the Brahmins, who are the priests, and the Rajputs, who are also called Kanes in the local language. And you have the Bajgis, you have the drummers. So it's a very, very simple caste differentiation, that you have Pujari, Rajput, you have the drummers, and then you have, so the drummers also include the carpenters, the people who do the, who work by hand. Because this was primarily a pastoral society, they were shepherds, they were grazing sheep. Most of the time, you do not have Vaishyas, you do not have the traders. So the Rajputs controlled the trade. They were the ones who brought in goods and took away goods. But you never had the Banya community. They just could not establish themselves. So these are the four castes that you have. And the menial jobs, the worst lot, are the Kolta or the Koli community. So it's a very simplified caste system. Though Mahasu is a devta, he's you cannot bracket him as Shiva or Vishnu or as one of the pantheon deities that we have. But it's fairly obvious that it's a Hindu caste society that we are looking at. So something changed historically in this society in 1816. So before 1816, it was the Gurkhas that came in and occupied this entire area. So Garhwal, Kumaon, this entire region was occupied by the Gurkhas. And the British came in 1815. In 1816, they fought battles with the Gurkhas, and the Nepalese kingdom had to surrender. So the surrender happened at Sagoli, which is somewhere near Gorakhpur. And things changed after that. So again, this multiplicity, again, this complexity of India not being one uniform space. The complexity is that unlike most other parts of the world, most other parts of India, colonialism was welcomed by the people. It was not as traumatic an experience as it was for, say, people living in UP or people living in Delhi or other spaces, because the Gurkha rule in itself was very exploitative. The Gurkhas were very cruel. Despite following the same religion as the locals did, they were much more rigid in their attitudes. They were much more cruel with the people. So I tend to believe that the Jaunsaris would have welcomed the British into Jaunsar. And the historical records that I could lay my hands on, was they also point out to the fact that the Jaunsaris had already risen up against the Gorkhas even before the British, entered this region. So, when the British came into Jaunsar, the Jaunsaris, they were already fighting the Gorkha, and the British kind of liked this attitude. They started looking at the social practices, like you see one of these old pictures from the 1850s, taken by a British photographer called Crook, who talks of Mahasu, and he shows a picture of women dancing at the temple of Mahasu near Mussoorie. And he says Mahasu, or rather four deities known collectively under this title, so the four kings that I talked about, is the spirit of a great worker of wonders. That's the caption he writes. And then he says, who could cause storms to disperse by throwing rice and lentils into the air? His temples are now served by Brahmin priests who offer to him male kids, so it's male kids in terms of goats, money, rice, water, and narcissus flowers. The god is here being appeased by music and dancing. So this is how the British viewed Mahasu. And so during the course of my research, I got an opportunity to read up a lot of the British records in 1820s, when Major Young was the administrator in Dehradun, and a lot of the settlement cases, land settlement cases, were being fought between the Rajas, between the Zamindars, and in a very famous case between the Raja of Tihri and the Zamindars of another area called Bakan. Major Young himself traveled to the temple of Mahasu and sought his judgment, when he himself could not pronounce judgment on the case because no one listened to him. No one accepted him as a judge. So he went to the temple and he said, he wrote to the Governor General saying that I'm going to follow the principles of justice which are locally followed, and Mahasu is going to settle this land dispute. So that was Mahasu's control over power in those times. And when the British came, once again, the focus of the archive shifted to the local practices. And one of the practices that most anthropologists of those times have focused on is the practice of polyandry, which is also referred to locally as a Pandav Vivah. So one woman is permitted to marry five brothers, actually. So the British found this very fascinating. They also found practices like bride price. So it's, instead of dowry, it is the bride which fetches a price. Instead of the male going to the woman's house in a procession, it's the woman who comes to the male's house in a procession. So they found these practices which were very different from the mainstream practices in India. That became a tradition. The British started writing about it, and then after that, all the anthropologists of India followed. So what you get to read about Jaunsar is only about polyandry, and it's only about these practices, not the political practice, not the religious practice, not even the caste. So the British were very taken up by these practices. They loved, because this area was so different. They loved the area because it also reminded them of Scotland. You had these pine trees and you had beautiful landscapes. And they did not know how to deal with a divine king. So they were dealing with human kings. The policy was that we will not be able to handle the mountain kingdoms. So return the mountain kingdoms to the erstwhile rulers who were ruling there before the Gorkha. So most of the kingdoms were returned to the human kings, but when they came to Mahasu, they didn't know what to do, because this was an idol. This was just an image inside a box, who could not be accepted as king by the British agents. And therefore, they decided to keep the area to themselves. They said, okay, this is one beautiful part of the world that will be our resting place. Whenever we get bogged down by the heat and dust of Delhi, we are going to come to Jaunsar, Mussoorie, Garhwal, and enjoy. So, because they couldn't deal with the divine king, they kept it to themselves, and a law was framed in 1935, which is called the Government of India Act, which gave special status to Jaunsar. So, Jaunsar was designated as an uncommon area, which is not a part of the area that follow normal Indian practices. But the caste system continued. The caste system is exploitative, it is as exploitative as it is in other parts. And if you still look at Jaunsari society, you see castes, you see the Brahmin priests. Of course, it's a completely Rajput dominated society. So, even the Brahmin is subjugated to the Rajput. The Rajput is always in a state of giving. So, the Rajput will always appear like this. The Brahmin will always appear like this, in a state of begging. Similarly, the Koltas, similarly the Bajkis, and the Rajputs own the land. And so, following the colonial practice, following the 1935 law, when India became independent, the Jaunsaris, they were given scheduled tribe status, because the British had said that they follow particularized practices, they follow particular systems which are different from the rest of the country. They need to be treated differently. But the caste system was very much there. The religion was Hindu, so it was a Hindu caste society. But because the British had thought of it as, considering some of the practices, they had thought of it as a different land, the Government of India also decided to designate Jaunsar as a tribal region.
What caste is the oracle?
The oracles are, they can be Rajput as well as Brahmin.
How are they selected?
They have to prove the authenticity of their possession. So, they have to come to the temple, they have to get possessed. And some of the senior oracles have to say that, okay, this looks genuine. So, once it looks genuine, then people will come and consult them. So, now what you happen is that, what happens in the area is, what you see is that there are the Kolis and the Koltas, who are like the minions, who are the very, very marginalized group. And then you have the drummers and Bajgis, like these people sitting outside the temple. So, they can sit outside the temple, they can do their drumming, but they cannot touch the temple wall. So, caste is kind of defined in the society in several ways. Whenever there is a temple dance, it is the Rajput. So, they create these, they mimic animals like elephants, which are created out of wood frames. The Rajput sits on the elephant, carries the swords, while it's the Bajgis and the Koltas who carry the frame. And so you can caste system manifests itself in so many ways. Like for instance, if you have the Bajgi or if you have the Kolta, they are not allowed to use the normal address of Ram Ram. When they meet another Rajput, they cannot say Ram Ram. They will only say Maharaj Maharaj. The Rajput will say Ram Ram. So, you know, these are the things. For instance, if the Kolta comes to the Rajput home and asks for his wages, he cannot stand at the door. He has to stand beside the door. So, these are nuances, and it's a very nuanced caste system, the manner in which it plays itself out in the society. But now what happens is that you have affirmative action from the government. The government wants to end this system, and the government wants to create egalitarianism, that everyone should be treated the same way, and they declare the area as a tribal area. So, the Rajputs become tribals overnight, the Brahmins become tribal overnight, the Kolta becomes tribal, and the Bajgi also becomes tribal So all of them are designated tribal, and the district magistrate says that since you get the benefit of a tribal society, now you do not have any caste reservations in this area. Everyone gets treated equally. So it is affirmative action from the government. They want to create, you know, a system where everyone is treated equally. But what we are actually doing is what Andre Bethe describes as the creamy layer effect, that within the society, by implementing such rules, we create a creamy layer. So because the Rajput have access to all the education, they have access to reservations, so they go into the IAS, they go into the IPS, they go into the government service, and they start working towards, you know, again exploiting the lower classes, lower castes, to perpetuate the system. So you have the Rajputs who rule now as tribals, so they have all the reservation benefits for tribals, and they are the ones who keep, you know, using the benefits of tribal reservations. And whenever the Koltas and the Kolis, they begin to talk about reservations for them, as reservations are given in Himachal Pradesh to the scheduled castes, those benefits are not given to them. So now within the Mahasu realm, half of it is in Himachal, half of it is in Uttarakhand. In Himachal, there is no scheduled tribe reservation. Only the Jaunsaris are given scheduled tribe reservation. So the Mahasu subjects in Himachal, they get caste reservation. And Himachalis are always dissatisfied that the Jaunsaris are better off because they are a tribe. Unko to tribal benefit milta hai, they are deriving all the benefits, humko bhi milna chahiye. So they keep petitioning the government of India saying that we are also equally backward, we also practice polyandry, we also have drunkenness, alcoholism as very common, we also grow poppy. We also grow drugs in our fields, so make us tribals. Whereas the lower castes in Jaunsar are very dissatisfied because they find their brethren in Himachal getting the benefit of the scheduled caste status. So what the lower castes in Jaunsar are doing is that they are trying to leverage their backwardness. So they are saying we are alcoholics, we are a polyandrous society, even though they are not. But they are making petitions to the state government, they are making petitions to the central government that we are as backward as the others. So you give us tribal status as well as a scheduled caste status. We should get benefits of both. And again, as I said, that caste, as we see it as a uniform system followed all over India, is not in that form seen in Jaunsar. It is very different. It is a phenomenon which was created by the British archive, as I said earlier. And it's not about purity and pollution. It's about dominance and power. Most of the social scientists who looked at caste, they've looked at it in terms of that ye Brahmin hai, purity, and the lower castes, they are the polluting castes. So the polluting castes should get benefits, they should get reservations. It doesn't work like that in Jaunsari society, and in most societies, I feel, because it's more about power, it's more about political dominance. Whoever dominates politically wants to keep a stranglehold over power. They do not want to let it go away. And so they have a stake, they have a vested interest in perpetuating that system. And so this is how caste plays out in the temples of Jaunsar. So the Kolta, the lower castes, they can come up to the courtyard, not beyond. They cannot even touch the temple walls. Then the Bajgis, if you see at the bottom, you'll see the boundaries. So the drummers can come up to the gate. And And then the Rajputs, they can of course enter the temple, and only the priests enter the sanctum sanctorum. And caste is it's politically very sensitive, even now in Jaunsar. Our Rajya Sabha MP Tarun Vijay, who's in his constituency Jaunsar Falls, is still, of course, his term has just expired, but he's been leading a movement for temple entry for the Dalits. So he wanted to project himself as a Dalit Messiah, and he was trying to get koltas inside the Mahasu shrines all the time. Got beaten up sometime, and this is a grab of the news where our chief minister is saying that in the 21st century you cannot stop someone from entering the temple. And on the other picture you see Tarun Vijay with all the bandages, beaten up because he was trying to take a group of Dalits inside the temple. So it's an issue, and caste is very intensely negotiated even today. So sometimes you have the lower castes saying that we are exploited, we are treated badly, we are still discriminated against. And at other times you have the same castes saying we are backward and we need to get reservations, we need to get benefits, and we don't get anything from being tribal. So this whole notion of being a tribal and being a lower caste person is working at odds with each other. And so what has happened because of this, we have Rajput hegemony, which is even more firmly entrenched. So you wanted to break the Rajput hegemony, you wanted to have the lower castes rising up, but you made the Rajput hegemony overpower even stronger by implementing what is called as affirmative action. And the Kolta, who were the lowest of the low castes, they were pushed to the margins even more. And then of course you have conflicts because of this, like we have seen in the case of Tarun Vijay. So while I was doing my research, I studied the case of this guy who is called Nanlal Bharti. He comes from the Kolta caste. And as you can see, he wears a hat. So the Koltas are the lowest of the low castes. They are supposed to wear a particular kind of headgear, which is a cap, which is like a kulu cap, if you have seen a kulu cap. So their headgear is like a kulu cap, but it is inverted. Only the Rajput can keep the shiny part in front to show that he is a Rajput. So the Koltas are supposed to use the term Das after their name. So he should have been called Nandlal Das, but he refused to use the word Das, and instead he used the word Bharti, which means of India. So it's a kind of a rebellious statement, and he refuses to wear the Das hat also. And he wears a westernized hat all the time. He leads a group of folk dancers, and which has brought him fame, which has brought him a lot of acceptance in society. He has even represented Jaunsar in the Republic Day parade in Delhi, and he travels all over the country and other parts of the world as well to perform the Jaunsari folk dances. So in the year 2006, Nandlal Bharti participated in a ritual in the temple at Hanol, when all the social activists got together and they said that today is the day when we should end the caste system in Jaunsar, and we should at least allow the Dalits and the women to enter the temple. And Nandlal Bharti, because he's a famous artist, he's a well-known person, he was asked to hold the mic and be the master of ceremonies, which empowered him a lot, so he thought that this was a change, that this was a complete change, and from now on the Dalits would be allowed to enter the shrine. So Nandlal Bharati, after the ritual, after everything was announced that from today onwards Dalit and women, Dalits and women would be allowed to enter, went to Delhi to perform at the Republic Day Parade. And when he went back, he went to say thanks at the temple. So he and some of his troop members, they brought in their gifts to the deity. So when you bring a gift to the deity, it's usually a goat. You bring a goat and the goat is beheaded, it is sacrificed and given to whoever is brought. The parts of it is kept for the bajgis. So interestingly, even with the goat, you know, the limbs are given to the Rajputs. So the limbs are given to the Rajputs, the head is given to the Brahmins, to the Pujaris, and the blood is given to the Koltas. So the Koltas only get the hooves and the blood of the goat. The rest of the meatier parts are given to the higher castes. So Bharti went with his gifts to the deity and he was caught by some of the priests in the temple and questioned as to how he had dared to enter the temple. So he began by saying that you had announced at the temple that the caste system has ended. The district collector was also here and these are the laws of India. You cannot stop people from entering into the temple. And he was beaten up. He was given a sound beating. And as he told me that one of the priests also brought out Mahasu's sword to behead him, to sacrifice him. And at that point he decided to hold a protest. At that point he was, he said that we cannot take this anymore and we have to hold a protest. And of course the media became a part of it and it became a very big issue in Jaunsari politics. So he kept doing his protest until the district magistrate was forced to send the SDM to ensure that they entered the temple. So the entry was forced inside the temple despite all the protests, despite all the opposition from the Rajputs and from the priests. But the SDM who accompanied him took him inside the temple, but he could not force the priests to open the door of the inner sanctum. So when they came out, the media questioned them that what did you do? That this man is so dissatisfied. He has gone inside the temple, but he has not seen the deity. He has not seen the God. The God has not accepted his gift. So the SDM replied that even the Devi Devtas have human rights. That was his reply to the media, that if the Dalits have their human rights, then the Brahmins also have their human rights, the Rajputs also have their human rights. And according to Indian laws, I could take him inside the temple, but I couldn't force the priests to open the door of the inner sanctum if they didn't want to do it. They also have their human rights. If they don't want to open the door, they will not open the door. So this is how it was explained, at which point Nandlal Bharti again began a very big protest at the district magistrate's office in Dehradun. And this was the time when the media played a very big role. They started questioning the entire legal system in India. And surprisingly, even when I talked to Nandlal Bharti about this entire issue, he came back to me and said that I have nothing against Mahasu Devta. Mahasu Devta is our Devta, he treats everyone equally. It's the Brahmins who are exploiting us, it's the Rajputs who are exploiting us, it's the administration that is not able to do its job properly. But I have nothing against the king, I have nothing against the Devta Raja. So he still swears by the Devta Raja, but the point is that caste and tribe, you know, this entire balance is playing out in such a way that Nandlal Bharti has become a kind of a political figure who has led this great movement for allowing the Dalits inside the temple of Mahasu. But on the other hand, he also sits in protests, he also sits in dharnas, asking for caste reservations for his community, saying that we are backward and traditionally we've been uneducated, alcoholism is rampant in our community, so give us reservations. So at one point he is trying to go forward with his identity and he is confused as to whether he should be asking for a backward status or a forward status for his community. And I think we must understand caste in those terms. We must understand and look at caste as a transactional strategy, as a strategy of, you know, give and take of power. That those who have control over power will try to sit over it, and those who do not will try to break that structure. And state has a very important role to play in all this. So people look up to the district magistrates, people look up to the government officers to change things. But are they up to it? Do they understand what is happening in the society? Because here I've seen most of the officials who come to Jaunsar are on punishment postings. So the Jaunsar posting in itself is looked at as a punishment posting. And they come to the hills with their ideas from the plains. So they say ki nahi ye to andhvishwas hai, superstition hai, black magic, we don't want to get into this. And a lot of funny situations have arisen, like for instance for Hanol there is a temple committee and there was this one lady SDM who was herself a Dalit, and she became by being the SDM, she became the chairman of the temple committee, chairperson of the temple committee, but she was not allowed inside. One, because she was a woman, and two, because she was a Dalit. And then she had to force her entry into the temple, and the moment she came out, four goats were sacrificed, the entire temple was washed clean once again. So these are the situations that arise when one is not aware of what local practice is. So I think that will be all. Thank you.